No one really knows when or where the first baseball game was played, or who invented the game. Maybe it truly was Abner Doubleday, here in the village of Cooperstown, New York in 1839. Or so goes the legend. Baseball grew up after the Civil War, becoming the national pastime. And it remains today an American obsession for those who once played the game and wished they still could. The earliest professional teams began searching for a way to knock off the rust from winters of sedentary indulgence. This inspired an annual rite known as spring training, which caught on in the Arkansas resort town of Hot Springs. From the 1880s through the early part of the 20th century, the best who ever played the game came to work on their hitting and pitching and fielding in preparation for long seasons ahead, with such teams as the Dodgers and Red Sox, and the Monarchs and Crawfords and Grays. They were the first boys of spring, and this is their story.
Let's bail those things.
All right, stand the man.
And word went out that here's a great place to not only play baseball, but perhaps most importantly, get in physical condition to have a successful season.
Ownership felt they needed to boil out the alcoholic microbes. Hot Springs was known as a place that had therapeutic waters, and they came for that reason. And then the ball players turned out to love it because they really not only did get in shape, but they had a great time. These were the greatest players at the peak of their greatness, all gathering in the same small town. So you would have Honus Wagner, Babe Ruth, Tris Speaker, Cy Young, all these guys would be together in the same nightclubs, the gambling casinos, the ball fields.
The history is real here. We don't have to try to manufacture anything, dramatize anything, exaggerate anything. History was played right here.
Every big leaguer and his wife should teach their children to pray. God bless Mommy, God bless Daddy, and God bless Babe Ruth. Wait hoit.
Hot Springs was a mixture of the bawdy and the elegant. The tubs of Bathhouse Row attracted visitors from around the country, the healing waters bringing a relief for arthritis or rheumatism or other discomforts long before drugs had been concocted to do the job. The horse races, the illicit casinos, the women of leisure, the mixed cocktails gave the visitors something to do when they were feeling better from their treatments. Lee Modfeld.
In March of 1918, George Herman Ruth was in Hot Springs staying at the Majestic Hotel and working out with the Boston Red Sox at Whittington Park, their spring training field. It was his fourth spring at the Arkansas Spa, a place that offered everything he loved, baseball and golf, and gambling and carousing. Lee Montville, author of The Big Bam, The Life and Times of Babe Ruth, writes that Ruth was a perpetual conventioneer on the prowl.
I wish that the team still trained in places like that, where they had brothels and horse racing and gambling and everything. I think he got into all of it. I think he just went crazy.
It was here at Boston's Fenway Park where Ruth made his major league debut, a season before his first spring in Arkansas.
When Babe Ruth started training in Hot Springs, Arkansas, in his early years with the Red Sox, he was just a wild, untamed guy. He'd grown up in Baltimore, Maryland, at the St. Mary's Industrial School for the boys, and when he came out of there, he was like just Hercules Unchained. The whole world was out there to take a big bite of, and he just never stopped biting.
1918 was a pivotal year for Ruth. Jidge, as his friends called him, was 23, already one of the dominant left-handed pitchers in the game. He could throw a fastball by anyone. But he could also hit, and he began to lobby management to be in the lineup every game, even when he wasn't on the mound. He started clubbing so many balls out of Whittington Park in batting practice that owner Harry Frazee fined him $10 for lost baseballs. Babe's response? They ought to make these parks bigger. On St. Patrick's Day, in the first game of the spring, Ruth hit a home run over the center field wall that was last seen headed for the reptile house across the street. A week later, in the third inning of a game with Brooklyn, the Babe crushed a grand slam off right-hander Al Mamaw that might still be the farthest a baseball has ever been hit.
Right here, left side of home plate, and hit a ball that landed on the fly over 500 feet away in the Arkansas alligator farm.
The very first ball pitch just suited Babe, and he put his whole weight behind the drive. The sphere cleared the fence by about 200 feet and dropped into the pond beside the alligator farm, while the spectators yelled with amazement. Paul H. Shannon, Boston Post, March 25th, 1918.
That might be the best point to pinpoint to is the pitcher's mound.
So how far did Ruth's ball travel? To discover the answer, B&F Engineering was hired to investigate.
Look how good it sits in there.
Using eyewitness accounts, an old aerial photograph, and modern surveying equipment, they determined the original location of home plate.
Right there?
Right there it is.
That's home plate.
You got it?
Yep, got it.
Along with landmarks that exist today as they did in the Babe's time, including Whittington Avenue and the Gator Farm and Petting Zoo that opened in 1902, still in business at the same address.
What we went back to was a 1965 aerial photograph before this parking lot existed here in the back of Weyerhaeuser, and we were able to geo-reference that, and you can actually see the diamond shape of the baseball field. There were remnants of the fields to here, and most certainly the pitcher's mound home plate area, and also the back of the grandstands.
All right, I'm getting the location now.
The distance was measured from home plate to a pond where alligators still swim.
Once we knew the location of home plate and were able to measure its location, we then went to just right in the middle of the alligator pond itself and took the measurement. And at that point, we knew how far the home run was. 573 feet.
Man, I can't imagine hitting a shot like that over this fence.
Yep,
these ponds have been here forever.
In an era before weight training and performance-enhancing drugs, it seems implausible, if not impossible, to fathom a ball player from any era hitting a ball 573 feet. But remember, he was Babe Ruth, and as teammate Joe Dugan once said, to understand him, you had to understand this. He wasn't human.
But the Babe, when he was in the orphanage at St. Mary's Industrial School for Boys, his hero was a big priest who would hit these fungo shots up in the air for the boys to catch the fly balls. And he would hit the ball very high, and he swung upwards to hit the fungos. He was the Babe's model. And the Babe had a big kind of what turned out to be a home run swing.
I have often been asked the difference between a baseball swing and a golf swing. Now you watch me, I'll show you.
Oh boy, he was a good golfer. He could hit that thing a mile, they say. And he went up to the Hot Springs Country Club a lot. And he would play two and three rounds a day sometimes.
The follow through in both is exactly alike.
When Ruth would come here, he would hike the trails. He would take the baths. He did that, and he did it very seriously. Played a lot of golf, would like to go to the horse races, but during the day, he would work very hard.
Photographs of Babe Ruth have started turning up over and over again in Hot Springs through the years and showing him really enjoying life. He would go out early in the morning to Oaklawn Park, the thoroughbred track, and he would run around the oval at the track.
After Ruth was sold to the Yankees following the 1919 season, he continued to visit Hot Springs prior to joining his New York teammates in Florida. In 1922, he settled a salary dispute by a coin flip in the lobby of the Eastman Hotel. The team owner tossed a half-dollar piece in the air. Babe called tails, and when it landed Ruth's way, he'd secured a three-year deal worth $1,000 a week, with a bonus of $500 for each home run.
The Yankees did not train there, but he trained there, and a bunch of ball players went there as like a pre-spring training session. A lot of them would go to Hot Springs before they'd even go to spring training to lose some weight. And that was the idea with the Babe.
In 1925, Babe Ruth showed up in Arkansas, fat and ready for fun.
He ate, he drank, he gambled, he partied.
After the baths, he would be so ready to go into town to get to the nightlife, he would skip the cold shower at the end of the bath and just throw on some clothes and just go. So his pores would be wide open and the nights would be a little cool. And invariably, he'd wind up with a bad cold or the influenza or something.
Yankee management heard the Babe was living large and ordered their franchise slugger to leave town. Soon he was stricken with what became known as the bellyache heard round the world and missed the first half of the season.
Babe was Babe, and he tended to get into a little too much trouble here.
The Yankees made sure he would never again be seduced by the preseason temptations of Hot Springs.
Babe Ruth became the biggest money generator in baseball. When he joined the Yankees, the new ownership wanted to get him out of Hot Springs. He was just having too good a time.
Through the high windows, the sunlight enters and pierces the curling masses of vapor which rise slowly in the heavy air. A man becomes a creature of three conditions. He is about to take a bath. He is taking a bath. He has taken a bath. Stephen Crane, Hot Springs, Arkansas, 1895.
Hot Springs became a national reservation in 1832 and still operates as a national park. In the 1870s, passenger trains began delivering vacationers. Opulent hotels and bathhouses were built to funnel steaming mineral water that escaped from the rocks into soothing hydrotherapy. But the streets were not paved, and the location was isolated in a valley amidst the hills of Arkansas. A New York Times reporter visiting in the 1880s wrote that Hot Springs had so many good points counteracted by so many bad points that he could have described the place as either the banner town of America or the worst hole in the world. Liz Robbins is director of the local historical society.
The springs were the reason for our existence and for our booming. In fact, a lot of the magazines and advertisements of the time called us nature's sanitarium.
Aristocrats and gamblers came on holiday. African-American men found seasonal jobs as waiters, bellhops, and masseurs. As the young sport of baseball grew in popularity, some of the hotels sponsored teams for black ballplayers. All this caught the attention of the owner of the top professional team in the land, Al Spalding of the Chicago White Stockings, and his player-manager, Cap Anson. Chicago had a championship club, but during the offseason, the boys partied hard, ravaging their athletic bodies with whiskey.
Players of that time were really, for the most part, pretty rough characters. They were minimally educated, and drinking was a real problem.
They had their nights off, and they would find their way to the local saloon and do what was considered the manly thing, which was drink themselves silly.
Hot Springs, thought Anson and Spaulding, was the perfect spot for the boys to sober up and work out.
All the boys are enthusiastic about it, and all want to go. I've written to a professor down there, and he's making arrangements to build a vat in which he can boil the whole nine at once. Boil out the alcoholic microbes, which may have impregnated the systems of these men during the winter, while they've been away from me and Anson. Al Spaulding.
Rather than work out indoors at a Chicago gymnasium or play exhibitions in chilly weather against American Association teams, Anson introduced a most revolutionary training concept prior to the 1886 season. He took his team south for spring training. It was the first foray into the American South for a major league team and remains, of course, one of the game's most enduring and endearing rituals. Anson selected Hot Springs, Arkansas as the site for his preseason conditioning, becoming the first manager to make the Southern preseason journey an annual ritual. Marty Appel.
It was big news when the White Stockings trekked south, making the front page of the very first edition of what would become the Bible of baseball, The Sporting News, published March 17, 1886.
They needed a flat piece of ground. They found a goat farm there that they were able to lease for the 1886 season. They used it. They later bought that property. But as they went back in 1886, you know, what happens? They win the National League.
I played a game of baseball. I belonged to Casey's nine. The crowd was feeling jolly and the weather, it was fine.
The biggest draw on that White Stockings team was the handsome, hook-sliding Mike King Kelly. Marty Appel of New York is author of the book Slide Kelly Slide, a biography of baseball's first superstar.
An oil painting of him sliding into second base replaced paintings of Custer's Last Stand at many Irish saloons throughout Boston. The song Slide Kelly Slide was written in his honor, and not only was it an important song in the American Songbook, but it was the first pop hit record that was developed after Edison patented the phonograph.
One of Kelly's pals was teammate Billy Sunday, an outfielder. Following a night out drinking with teammates, Sunday had a spiritual conversion. Eventually, he quit baseball and devoted the rest of his life to preaching against the sins of imbibing.
America needs a tidal wave of the old-time religion. America needs to be taken down to God's bathhouse and the hose turned on her.
He was as hard drinking as the rest of them, but one day he just saw the light, realized that religion was his calling, and swore into temperance and would never drink again. And when he went back to the White Stockings and said, "Boys, I have to share with you, I'm through with that life. I'm no longer going to be drinking. I have found the Lord and I'm going to be spreading his word." Kelly was the first guy to come forward and shake his hands and said, "Well, religion's not my strong suit, but I wish you well. And, you know, I think it's great what you're doing."
The White Stockings, later renamed the Cubs, came back to train in Arkansas eight more times in the 1800s. It was during this period that Cap Anson became notorious for refusing to play against integrated teams, drawing a color line that would last until broken by Jackie Robinson in 1947.
I always tell people Cap Anson is the poster child for keeping African Americans off the major league diamond. Well, he's really just one poster child. There were many.
He was a segregationist, big time. He did not want any blacks coming into the league at all.
An early effort to circumvent the unwritten color barrier was made by John Muggsy McGraw, a legendary manager once arrested by a U.S. Marshal for hustling tourists while pitching silver dollars into a saloon basket in front of the Arlington Hotel.
McGraw was described as this little poobah, who is a very prominent figure around Hot Springs.
That's it. Good play, good play.
In 1901, McGraw came to town searching for talent for the Baltimore Orioles and heard about an exotic-looking African-American player who was working as a bellman at the Eastman Hotel.
Every day when he would get ready to come out and watch some of the other teams work out, some of the black bellhops would stop him and say, "Mr. McGraw, you need to see a fellow we've got that plays on our hotel team. He is as good as any of these baseball players in town. His name's Charlie Grant."
McGraw concocted a scheme to pass off Grant as an American Indian named Chief Charlie Tokahoma of the Cherokee Nation. Author Phil Dixon wrote about the story in his book, A Harvest on Freedom's Fields.
At first, Muggsy thought he was a Negro and was about to tell him to move on when he noticed his straight black hair. He walked over and took a look at him, then asked if he wasn't an Indian. Toki said he wasn't anything else.
Well, Charlie Grant was a great player in baseball, was unique in that he was a fair-skinned man. I guess the term of the day might have been mulatto, because he had light skin.
Newspaper reporters would want to know where this full-blooded Cherokee ball player came from, so they contacted Charlie Grant's mother in Cincinnati, and they had her go along with it.
That ultimately didn't fly because Charlie Grant was a little bit too well known. He wasn't able to fly under the radar as much as McGraw had hoped.
The ruse was given up, and Charles Comiskey of the White Sox found out about it, and certainly lodged complaints about the possibility of his playing, and they weren't able to recruit him for the team.
Spring training conditions back 100 years ago were pretty primitive. Not only did they share a room, two shared rooms, but they in the spring they would share beds. And now, of course, that would be absolutely unheard of, two men sharing a bed. You know, they all raise all kinds of questions.
Before Florida was invented, and most of the teams went there to train, baseball fans could stroll through the lobby of the Majestic Hotel on any spring evening and see many of the great diamond stars of the day engaged in prankish antics, playing cards, or just relaxing in the comfortable chairs. In Florida, if it rains, their successors have no mountains to climb and build up endurance, which may be one reason why baseball players of today are not as tough and long-lasting as they once were. D. Brown.
In those early spring training years, games could not be played on Sundays because of an Arkansas blue law that made it illegal, to quote the statute, for any club to engage in play of baseball in this state on the Christian Sabbath.
There actually were church-going ball players back then. They were ball players who didn't drink and didn't gamble and didn't whore around.
This church was the first Catholic church in Hot Springs. And just north of here is the famous Majestic Hotel where all the ball players would stay. And these guys would like to have a good time at night, but part of the Catholic tradition was to go to Mass regularly.
By the dawn of the 20th century, a belief in the healing powers of immersing in natural, sultry water had swept the nation. With an advertising slogan of "We bathe the world," a bathhouse row sprang up on Central Avenue, with proprietors claiming their tubs could cure paralysis, malaria, alcoholism, and ailments peculiar to women.
There were so many illnesses and conditions that medical science couldn't treat. People were desperate for a cure or for relief, and they truly believed that thermal spring water would help them. And doctors all over the country advised people to come for not just the thermal water, but the whole curing of mind and soul and body that you could get in this relaxed, beautiful place.
One, two, three. By 1910, 10 major league teams practiced in Hot Springs, including the Brooklyn Dodgers, the Red Sox, the St. Louis Perfectos, Cincinnati Reds, Cleveland Spiders and Indians, Detroit Tigers, the Pirates, Washington Senators, and New York Highlanders, who became the Yankees. Negro League teams that same year included the St. Louis and Leland Chicago Giants. And there were minor league teams including the Providence Grays and Toledo Mud Hens, all practicing and soaking in the bathhouses.
But they would start out early in the morning, hiking up on the mountains. They would come back in, there would usually be a morning practice, a scrimmage game. Then they would go and take one of the baths. I don't think that they truly understood anything other than it perhaps they felt like boiled out some fat and loosened up their muscles. And that's what they were looking for. They wanted to loosen up those muscles.
Maybe there was something in that torrid water that was piped into those old bathhouses. 22 teams that trained here won either American or National League pennants, including 11 World Series champions.
The normal course of baths was for about 3 weeks. You had 21 baths, one a day, and you'd have an attendant to wait on you. And there was a kind of a set regime that you went through, take about an hour and a half. You also had massage available afterward, something that a lot of players did. In the early 1900s, when they discovered that the waters were slightly radioactive, that was an inducement to come here as well and take the baths, get a little bit more energy for your upcoming season.
The Red Sox trained here for all or parts of 14 preseasons, starting in 1909. Following the club by trainload was a rabid fan club known as the Royal Rooters. Their leader, Boston pub owner Michael Nuff said McGreevy, is often pictured in team photos, wearing a Boss Sox uniform.
There'd be arguments among the breakout in the saloon over baseball matters back and forth. And at one point, he would slam his fist on the bar and say, "Nuff said," and that would end the argument.
McGreevy and his men would sit in their own section in the stands, singing their theme song, Tessie. Author Charles Alexander, a retired history professor, lives in Ohio near the birthplace of one of the legendary names in baseball lore, longtime commissioner Kennesaw Mountain Landis. Alexander has written biographies of a number of baseball Hall of Famers, including the slick fielding outfielder on those pre-Babe Ruth Red Sox teams, Tris Speaker, known as the Gray Eagle for his silver hair.
He played center field better than anybody ever had. And he played, he had his own unique style of playing a shallow center field. So he was known to catch line drives in short center field and beat a runner back to second base to double him off. He actually completed several unassisted double plays from center field. In his time, and for a long time thereafter, even when I was growing up, he was considered the greatest center fielder of all time.
Can I throw harder than Joe Wood? Listen, my friend, there's no man alive can throw harder than Smokey Joe Wood. Walter Johnson.
The star pitcher on those Red Sox clubs was Smokey Joe Wood, a fireballer who won 57 games between 1911 and 12 and seemed destined for the Hall of Fame.
Joe Wood had an incredibly fast fastball. The only other player that he was compared with was Walter Johnson. Wood knew he was fast, and he knew he had the potential to hurt people.
A Author Gerald Wood writes that after a scary beaning of Pittsburgh third baseman Bobby Byrne in March 1913,
there was a history of fear that he had about hurting a player like that. And it was something that he carried with him his whole life, not just in 1913, but after that. Even when Bobby Byrne played for four more years, even when Bobby Byrne had one of his great seasons in 1913, even when Bobby Byrne played against Joe Wood's team, the Red Sox, as a member of the Philadelphia Phillies in 1915, Joe continued to be afraid, to believe, in fact, that he had hurt Bobby Byrne so much that day that he shortened Byrne's career.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Whittington Park between the Pittsburgh Pirates and the Boston Red Sox.
No teams played one another more often in Arkansas than Pittsburgh and Boston.
Batting third for the Pirates and playing shortstop, Honus Wagner.
The Pirates franchise player Honus Wagner was an exceptional athlete who hit for power and average and dominated games with his base running. Said Ty Cobb of the Flying Dutchman, "He is not only a marvelous mechanical player, but he has the quickest baseball brain I have ever observed."
There is something Lincoln-esque about him, his rugged homeliness, his simplicity, his integrity, and his true nobility of character. Arthur Daly, New York Times.
He was stubby, he was strong, he was bow-legged, he was fast. He was up there with Ty Cobb as far as speed.
To stay in condition during the offseason, Wagner captained a traveling basketball team. In the winter of 1909, Honus volunteered to teach some Hot Springs high school boys how to play on the hard court.
They really didn't know the rules of the game. They didn't know how to execute plays. And also, he would go to Hot Springs High School every afternoon and work out with the basketball team. Wagner went back. He sent back the uniforms that his traveling Pirate basketball team had worn the year before. He sent shoes and a couple of balls so that the team would have everything they needed to play the game. And to this day, Hot Springs High School still honors that gift with their school colors of black and gold.
At the zenith of the era, in the second decade of the 1900s, 250 professional ball players could be found working out in Hot Springs at any given time. Trolley cars made it easy to get around. There were movie houses and billiard parlors and horse racing tracks to entertain the players and fans, along with some quirky tourist attractions.
Well, they would definitely go to the Alligator Farm, which was on Whittington Avenue, close to the ballpark. It had hundreds of alligators, which didn't do very much, but were fun to watch, particularly at feeding time when they fed them chickens. They could go a little farther down the street to the ostrich farm, which was actually more energetic and exciting because they had races between ostriches on a quarter of a mile racetrack. You could drive a buggy pulled by ostriches. Or you could go further down Central Avenue and go to the Happy Hollow Amusement Park, which was several blocks long and had elaborate hillbilly or fake country storefronts and costumes you could wear for comical pictures. There was definitely gambling. There were gambling clubs like the Southern Club, the Kentucky Club, the Texas Club. There was also a lot of prostitution. It was a wide open town.
It was wild. It was in the sense of it was majestically beautiful. But they had the casinos. They had the horse racing. The weather was invigorating for them. And the people, they loved the whole atmosphere.
Baseball was always a draw, with exhibition crowds packing the stands by the thousands. A new, livelier ball added to the excitement.
In the National League, a baseball was introduced late in the 1910 season that had a cork center added to it. Previous to that time, baseball had been horsehide covered, wrapped in two different grades of yarn, hard rubber center. That was the so-called dead ball. Well, it didn't carry. If a ball was fouled up into the stands, park attendant would, or policeman would go over, get the ball from the fan, throw it back on the field, or the fan would throw it back on the field himself. Bat boy would take it, throw it, give it to the umpire, or throw it directly to the pitcher, the ball would stay in play. There wasn't at all uncommon for maybe three baseballs to be used during the course of a game.
Age is about mind over matter. If you don't mind, it don't matter. Satchel Paige.
Many of the top Negro League teams also trained in Hot Springs, where there was a vibrant entertainment district known as Black Broadway. Upscale hotels and nightclubs catered to the African-American consumer.
Ball players used to tell me that they would take waiters' jobs in the off-season, and they'd learn how to carry their tray with one arm to kind of build up their pitching arm, keep their arm strong, you know, come spring, they're ready to play ball.
For the most part, for African-Americans, it wasn't a structured spring training that one might see today. The idea was you got in condition by playing baseball. Yes, you did some calisthenics and you did some warming up and you did some practice, but maybe you had a day or two of that, but then it was time to play ball.
While Major League and Negro League players sometimes barnstormed together in the off season, baseball remained a segregated game. There is no evidence black and white teams ever played one another on the fields of Hot Springs.
It was a parallel society in many respects. There was great baseball being played all around. There was great baseball being played in the white leagues. There's great baseball being played in the Negro major leagues. That doesn't make it any better. It doesn't make it any worse. It is what it is.
This was built in the early 1920s as the Woodman of Union Hotel. It was a full service hotel, including the Hot Springs baths. So if you wanted to stay at the best African-American hotel, this was where you would go.
Retired from the National Park Service, Mark Bloyer has done extensive research on the story of the Negro League teams that came here to train.
A lot of these African-American ball games were very well attended by whites too. But I will also say that the town of Hot Springs, even though it was segregated, was not as virulently so as many other places in the South.
In the spring of 1920, Rube Foster, owner of the Chicago American Giants, gathered a group of fellow owners in this YMCA building in Kansas City and founded the Negro National League. This provided organization to what had been an unstructured group of black teams that played across the Midwest and Northeastern United States.
Foster is a pivotal figure in sports history, period. You either loved him or hated him, but everyone respected him.
Foster's original venture to Hot Springs came in the 19th century when he was a young ball player with a team out of Waco, Texas. He found work in town and likely pitched for one of the hotel teams. A year after establishing the Negro National League, Foster brought his Chicago team to Arkansas for a series of early spring games.
He believed that the African-American ball player would be more powerful if they could take spring training like the major league teams. So he was the first person to take a team from the North back to the South.
Other black teams would follow, including the Kansas City Monarchs, Homestead Grays, and Pittsburgh Crawfords. The 1935 Crawfords that trained in Hot Springs might have been the best team ever fielded in the Negro Leagues, or perhaps any league. That Pittsburgh club included the fleet-footed James Cool Papa Bell.
Well, they said he was so fast he could turn the lights off and get in the bed before the room got dark.
Infielder Judy Johnson.
Judy Johnson was just a superb fielder and one of the smartest men in baseball.
slugging catcher Josh Gibson.
Josh Gibson, in my estimation, was the greatest power hitter that ever lived.
And Oscar Charleston, who said Dizzy Dean could hit a ball a mile.
Buck O'Neill used to say when Willie Mays came up and was a rookie player, they compared him to Oscar Charleston.
Those four Crawfords are all in the starting nine of the Field of Legends at the Negro Leagues Museum in Kansas City. Dr. Raymond Doswell is the museum's curator.
Well, first of all, it's important to note that the statues on our field represent ball players who were inducted into the National Baseball Hall of Fame when we built the museum. So they represent some of the greatest players of all time, especially those notable who were African-American players in the Negro Leagues.
Leroy Satchel Paige was the most famous of all the Negro League stars. Convinced scalding hot water kept his right arm and bones flexible, Hot Springs was long part of his preseason training routine.
At one time, they told me, Satchel told me he used to love to go to Arkansas for spring training simply because he liked the baths.
Bill McCrary played with Paige on the Kansas City Monarchs in the 1940s.
My nickname is Youngblood. He called all the ball players together and said, look here, now we have some Youngblood. And they started calling me Youngblood from that day on.
Youngblood joined the Monarchs at age 17. From shortstop and then the dugout, Bill had a catbird's view of one of Satchel's greatest all-time stunts.
We waited for Satchel Paige to get it to game, because we are already there, and about 15 minutes before game time, here comes Satchel Paige. He walks down to the dressing room, puts the uniform on, walks down to the bullpen. He throws three pitches. That's all he threw. And walked out on the mound and pitched seven innings of no hit, no run ball. In the seventh inning, he set everybody down but the catcher. Struck out the side and waved at the crowd.
All right, boys, we're ready to open the 1934 school. We've got some great instructors down here.
In the 1930s, a promoter named Ray Doan opened a popular winter baseball school that functioned for years on fields used by the big leaguers. Doan was familiar with the town, having been here with his House of David, a bearded barnstorming team named for an Israelite sect.
He also, it is said, invented donkey baseball and a form of softball where the infielders were tied to goats.
In peak years, the All-Star Baseball School attracted hundreds of hopeful boys in their teens and early 20s, who yearned to follow in the footsteps of Doan's faculty that included future Hall of Famer Dizzy Dean and famed spitballer Burley Grimes.
Well, we've just come on through that way. That
was... Tuition was $60, plus another $20 for room and board.
I think there were seven or eight of them that made it to the majors. Quite a few of them made it to the minors. They had scouts here during these baseball schools. And at the end of the school, or close to the end of it, the scouts would sign the better kids, you know, the more talented ones.
People ask me what I do in winter when there's no baseball. I tell you what to do. I stare out the window and wait for spring. Rogers Hornsby.
What's Hornsby here, boys? One of the greatest batters the National League has ever known.
Teaching the game helped Rogers Hornsby find something to do in the offseason other than staring out the window or losing money at Oaklawn Racetrack.
You boys want to take copy of this and
the Rajah is considered one of the greatest right-handed batters of all time with a .358 lifetime average. He had a reputation for being difficult with everyone, including his wives and teammates.
Odd character, really an odd character. I mean, he lived the way he wanted to, and yeah, he said to hell with everybody else.
Come on out to the plate now, you fellows, and we'll try and demonstrate what I was showing you here.
But he loved teaching boys, becoming the dean of Doan's camp, making $200 for 2 weeks of service.
One of the things that he enjoyed doing was to inculcate in them a love of baseball, because he always said, that's the only game. Why would anybody play anything else?
As a teenager, Mackenzie Eli Lambert amassed a museum's worth of memorabilia from the golden days of baseball in his hometown. His prized possession is this bat, used by Rogers Hornsby back when he taught kids to play the game he so loved.
This bat, first off, got a couple of different identifying marks on it. We know for certain that this is not a store-modeled bat due to the fact that it has only Rogers Hornsby's personal name on it. Factory records indicate that Hornsby ordered somewhere around 33 of these bats after his retirement from Major League Baseball. If you date the bat itself and you look such as the logo where it says Louisville Slugger, registered U.S. Pat Office, that allows us to know that the bat dates back to the 1950s.
If a ball club wants to get pitchers in good condition, they should send them to Hot Springs. Ben Johnson, President, American League.
In some years, only pitchers and catchers would show up.
Pitchers were more and more throwing the spitball and a variety of other so-called trick pitches. Generally speaking, pitchers were free to do whatever they wanted to do with the baseball. Knuckleball, spitball, emery ball, various means of mutilating the baseball.
Sounds good. Let's do it.
When the fields were too muddy, athletes could jog up the hills that surround the Valley of the Vapors. The bathhouses offered what little exercise equipment was available in those days. Cy Young, winner of more than 500 games, the most of any pitcher ever, received permission from the clubs he played for to work out on his own in Hot Springs, while his teammates trained in other southern towns. For 20 years, Cy came annually to limber up his arm, pitching for teams from Cleveland, St. Louis, and Boston. Lefty Grove credited the hot water with reviving his dead arm near the end of his Hall of Fame career. During the Roaring Twenties, the Dodgers, Boston Braves, and New York Giants trained in Hot Springs.
That's not the way to do it now. Here's the way you should do it.
But in 1930, after the stock market crash, only Connie Mack's Philadelphia Athletics trained at the Spa City.
And then let her go right through.
Leo's always at his charming best during infield practice.
The colorful Leo DeRocher brought his Dodgers here in 1939. His first season managing the storied bums from Brooklyn.
Talk about your civ infield, I got one here.
Off the field, Leo the Lip spent much of his time golfing and gambling and nearly lost his job after winning a pile of money at an illegal bingo game.
Where are you playing? Get over there.
In those early days, the idea was that you would come down here in the spring and get in shape in the nice warm weather. Well, some of those springs were not so warm. Florida began to sound better and better, a little more reliable.
In 1941, a few members of the Detroit Tigers, including Hall of Famers Hank Greenberg and Charlie Gehringer, were among the last major leaguers known to train in Hot Springs. Black teams kept coming to the very end of the Negro Leagues. In 1955, the Detroit Stars were the last of the professional clubs to make Hot Springs their spring training home, closing an era that spanned eight decades.
For those who enjoyed baseball, going to Arkansas meant it was time to play ball again, and it was time to get excited about another season. And that was something that they looked forward to every year.
Baseball historians Bill Jenkinson and Tim Reed are on an autumn pilgrimage to the mythical birthplace of the game, Cooperstown, home of quaint souvenir shops and the National Baseball Hall of Fame.
There they are, Tim.
Wow.
On this trip, their focus is on the players who made Hot Springs the birthplace of spring baseball, long before the hall opened in 1939.
These are the original guys.
What's amazing is that nearly 50% of all the inductees at Cooperstown played or trained at Hot Springs.
And it's staggering to see the names that are inducted in the first years, especially when the choice ranged over a 50-year period. Who are you going to pick? And the people they picked were people who played ball at Hot Springs.
These guys would come, sometimes with injuries, especially with the sore arms, and somehow, some way, they would heal in Hot Springs. Quite remarkable.
What would you give to watch those guys playing?
Just incredible. I mean, all in the small town, yeah. People would interface with them.
Yep. And here they are, from one small town to another. Right here, Cooperstown. What a story.
Americana at its best.
Absolutely.
Some of the legends of spring training's early formative years are also part of a lesser-known Hall of Fame that honors Irish-American players.
You're here at Foley's, 18 West 33rd Street, in the shadow of the Empire State Building in New York City. We started the Irish-American Baseball Hall of Fame about 8 years ago, basically to bring a new generation who mightn't be big baseball fans and educate them on some of the more colorful characters that came before.
And each year there's a wonderful induction ceremony here. And the year that they inducted Mike King Kelly, they asked me to accept because obviously no King Kelly and no knowledge of any descendants.
Hot Springs today remains a popular resort. The lakes and national park draw visitors to the town where Bill Clinton grew up. The Buckstaff on historic Bathhouse Row has been in continuous operation since 1912. The Arlington Hotel, with its Al Capone suite and sweeping veranda, is as enchanting as ever. The Woodman of Union Hotel, a favorite with African American ballplayers and entertainers, is now an apartment building. The Majestic Hotel, the once popular headquarters for big league teams, fell into years of abandoned disrepair and sadly burned up in a fire, a full century after Ruth and his teammates came here to relax in between games of baseball and nights on the town. But the fire spurred local vigor in the desire to preserve and restore historic Central Avenue, recognized as one of the 10 great streets in America. Oaklawn Park, which opened in 1905, remains an important track for thoroughbreds being groomed for the Triple Crown of horse racing. Youth leaguers can be found in the summertime playing at Old J.C. Park. On this very field on October 1st, 1952, a slugging teenager named Henry Aaron and the Indianapolis Clowns played one of 12 games of the Negro League World Series against the Birmingham Black Barons. And the story of baseball in Hot Springs is back. Historical markers connect to cell phones.
Team arrived in the Spa City in the middle of March 1886.
With stories about the legends of the game that made this place an annual destination.
And Hot Springs became the birthplace of spring training baseball.
On the walls inside the convention center is a permanent collection of vintage photos featuring rare and curious images, like this one of Tris Speaker sitting on a stuffed alligator.
For the average baseball fan, it's a great place to just drive, look around. It's a beautiful city too, it's a great place to visit. But for the experienced baseball fan or perhaps researcher, historian, there's a great deal of history. We're building on it every single day.
And Horace Vogel was the owner of the Phillies.
Author Don Duran and local baseball buff Mike Dugan were two of the driving forces in getting the historic baseball trail established. One of the sites is Fogle Field, where the likes of Honus Wagner fielded ground balls.
It is a beautiful field today.
Yeah, it is. It is.
And the Phillies only came the 1 year, didn't they?
One year.
Yeah.
And mainly because Horace Vogel got banned from baseball.
That'll do it.
Because he said some things about the establishment that they didn't like. So
that'll get you banned. You get the sense that it was once a great baseball field, a great park.
If the ghosts of baseball past are still here, they can be found at the site of Old Whittington Park, where the Babe hit his tape measure home runs. The ballpark disappeared generations ago, giving way to a timber company parking lot. The ruins of concrete bleachers stand against the side of a mountain where athletes hiked to get in shape. A home plate has been installed in the black asphalt where Pie Trainer and Rabbit Moranville hit and ran on a field of pale March green. Their spring hopes have faded into eternity. Their youthful images, frozen in colorless photographs, were bronzed and immortalized in halls of fame. Yet in their day, they were the first boys of spring.
Anyone who likes to go to Cooperstown should come here. They will be standing in the steps of the greatest players in the history of baseball.
Thank you.